Welcome to Behold the Real Jesus broadcast, brought to you by the Jesus Christ International Church, 325 South High Street, right here in Longview, Texas, zip code 75601. Well, neighbor, we want to thank God for you. We do count it an honor and a privilege to come into your homes and your businesses with this true Jesus. And we know you have been writing in and telling us and encouraging us, and we want to thank you, the listener, for encouraging us in this work of the ministry, in this Jesus revelation. Those that have sent offerings in, God bless you. We thank God for you, praying for you daily. Know that God is working in you, both the willing to do of his own good pleasure, and only a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple will in no wise lose your reward. Thank you again for your offerings, your gifts that you've sent in, and you've taken part in the gifts that we offer at the end of the broadcast, the books. And again, this helps us keep the broadcast on the air in your area. God bless you. Well, we've been talking about the work of the ministry. What are we called for? We know that we're not just called to sit on a pew and saying in the sweet by and by we're going to understand it all. No, there's a great work here in the present, in this present evil world, and this gospel of the kingdom, this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, the work of the ministry, this work of the ministry, where Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do. Jesus healed the sick, cleansed the leper, raised the dead, cast out devils, opened blind eyes, loosed the dumb tongue, the lame walk, and the captive went free. And he said, blessed is he whomsoever is not offended in me. Why? Because he is the great God and Savior. He with the finger of God cast out devils and manifested the kingdom of God. You've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said, the words that I speak are not mine, but the Father that dwelleth or houses permanently in me, he doeth the works. If you've seen Jesus in the days of his flesh, you've seen the Father. Why? Because he's the image of the invisible God. Therefore, to enter into this work, the primary foundation of all of it, of all the work of God, is the revelation of Christ in the doctrine of Christ. The doctrine of Christ is that Christ, searching what manner of time that the Spirit of Christ was in those Old Testament prophets, that Spirit of Christ, which they did prophesy by, of the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. And that is 1 Peter 1:10. Why? Because Christ is the Spirit of God. He is the Father of glory. He is the Word. He is the Holy Ghost. He is all that God is, was, or ever will be. And from the beginning, Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. All things were made by him, whether they be thrones, principalities, powers, things visible, invisible. Colossians 1:16-17, all things were created by Jesus Christ. Christ is the Spirit of God. But Christ, because man sinned, had to come down as a man. God came under his own law when he made himself of no reputation, not no deity, but no reputation. By putting off his glory, he was able to come under his own law as a man. Literally manifest, took upon him the form of a servant. He's in the form of God, and that is spirit. And he made himself of no reputation to come under his own law and took upon him the form of a servant made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, humbled himself to the death of the cross. Who was he? God manifest in flesh. Not the Son of God in flesh, God manifest in the flesh. For the knowledge of the Son of God in the last days is not just a gnosko. To understand that, we know Jesus not after the flesh anymore, but a general knowledge of God through having his Spirit. By having the Spirit in us, Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's a gnosko knowledge. It's a Greek word to have a general knowledge, knowing him after the Spirit. But where we're headed in the body of Christ is that work of the ministry that we've been preparing for over 2,000 years since the day of Pentecost, for the path of the justice as a shining light that shineth more and more into the perfect day. We are coming into a higher knowledge of Jesus Christ. You get that in Ephesians 4:11. What is that in Ephesians 4:11? It's the work of the ministry. And that's what we're talking about this week. And this work of the ministry, not just to sit on a pew, not just to go to church, not just to have fellowship, but to grow up into Him in all things. And this is the reason why that we must grow up into Him and know those things of Christ, which are the things of faith. For faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. What are the things? Jesus said, I have many things to tell your disciples. They'd been with Him for 3.5 years, but He said, you're not able to bear them now. Well, my Lord, if they'd been with Jesus for 3.5 years, seen Him heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, cast out devils, open blind eyes, loose the dumb tongue, the lame walk, captive go free, what else would they need? They knew He was a Savior. They knew He's God manifest in the flesh. They knew His name, Jesus, the Lord of glory. Yet, He said, I have many things yet to tell you, but you're not able to bear it now. He said, when the Holy Ghost has come, He'll speak of me, for all His Father's given unto me, and He will show you things of faith, things which will come to pass. We see that in Revelation 1. It's a revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto His servant things which must shortly come to pass. These things are the faith that was once delivered to the saints, but in the last days will be greater. Greater things, greater knowledge of the Lord. What is that? It's not a gnosko knowledge. Somebody said, well, I've got the Holy Ghost. I know Him. It's not just having the Holy Ghost. It's going up in Him. The Holy Ghost is given to them that obey Him. So it's a progressive glorification. Why sufferings? Well, tribulation worketh patience. Patience worketh experience. Experience worketh hope. Hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in the heart by the Holy Ghost. Paul exhorting the brethren that through much tribulation shall we enter into the kingdom of God. We're not only called to believe on Jesus, but also to suffer with Him. Why? Why all the sufferings? Didn't He bear it all on the cross? Jesus said, if any man come after me, let him deny himself, pick up his cross, and come follow me. Not his cross, not the Lord's cross, but your cross as an individual believer. Why? Because 1 Peter 4:1 says, for as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Why? Because sufferings is how we crucify the flesh with the affections and the lusts, that we are Christ, if though we be that we suffer with Him, so that we may reign with Him. That is the reason why in 2 Thessalonians 1, the faith that groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you aboundeth. One toward another, brethren, we're found to thank God for you and all your persecution and tribulation that you endure, which is a manifest token. A token of what? Of the righteous judgment of God. For when judgment's in the earth, men will learn righteousness. What is righteousness? Jesus came from God and went back to the God. He proceeded from the Father. He went back to the Father. He's a Father manifest in flesh in the days of His flesh, and He went back to His former glory there in that Jesus glorified with God's own self, John 17:5. Going back to the Father, 1 Timothy 6:15, Revelation 3:21, set S-E-T down with my Father in His throne. That is Jesus Christ, the God of glory. To understand that it's not just knowing Him after the flesh, but after the Spirit, is not a gnosko knowledge, but a higher revelation, a higher glory in Him, in the knowledge of the Son of God. For He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the work of the ministry, for the perfecting of the saints, until we all come into the unity of the faith. So many different denominations and schisms and divisions out there now. But when God does this work in the last days, it will bring the body of Christ into one. What? Through great sufferings, through great tribulation. Somebody said, well, I'm not going through the great tribulation. If you look at Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, you'll see that these, pray that your fight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day, for then shall be a time of great tribulation. Such as never was, such as was a nation, neither shall ever be again. And except those days be shortened, no flesh shall be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days are shortened. That is definitely the great tribulation. Come on down in verse 29 to 31 in Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 10, and Luke 21. It will say, and immediately after the tribulation of those days, shall the sign of the Son of Man appear in heaven, with great power and glory, and send his angels and gather get together his elect from the four corners of heaven to the four corners of the earth. Who's he gathering? The elect, the church, the elect of God, the chosen, called and faithful in God. When? Immediately after the tribulation of those days. So the work of the ministry for the perfecting of the saints until we all come into the unity of the faith and to the knowledge. The knowledge of the Son of God is not gnosko. It's not a general knowledge that we receive the Holy Ghost. It is those that have overcome, those that have grown up into him in all things, those that overcome to the end. And it's called an epi, E-P-I, epigonosko. Epi means higher, a higher knowledge. Epigonosko. That is the next season. That is the next glory of the church in the Feast of Trumpets, the ministry voice of Jesus Christ. Yes, that's right, neighbor. You are called for this work. It's for the work of the ministry. If you are in the bride of Christ and the body of Jesus Christ, then you were called for the work of the ministry, not just to warm a pew, not to give tithes and offerings to help some pastor and denominations, but to grow up into him, your Lord, your God, Jesus Christ. Yes, it's a great work. It's a high calling of God in Christ. You see, this was a mystery of God's will before the foundation of the world, that he would gather all things together in one in Christ. If you'll take a look at Ephesians 1, he said this is a great work of God, or workmanship created in Christ Jesus. This exceeding greatness of his power to usward, what he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand. What? For him? No, for us. Jesus paid a price for us that where he was there, where he is there, we may be also. And we are seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. How many seats are there in heaven? There are 4 and 20 seats, and those seats are the seats of Christ, and 24 is the number of the elders, or the number of the ministry of the Jesus ministry. And you're called, every individual, I don't care how old, how young, male or female, you're called for the work of the ministry, Ephesians 4:11. Until we all come into the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God. That's not a gnosko, that is an epi, higher knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, somebody said, is that the way Jesus knew the Father? No. No man knoweth the Son but the Father. No man knoweth the Father but the Son, unto whom he will reveal him. That knowledge that Jesus has of the Father is not gnosko or epigonosko. It is eido, E-I-D-O, which means that you know him because you are him. When you look in the mirror, you know who you are because you are him. That is, no man knoweth the Father like Jesus, it, because he is eido. He knows the Father in the Spirit because he is the Spirit of God. The Lord is that Spirit. 2 Corinthians 3:17, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we, the body of Christ, we all shall grow up into him. We all with open face, beholding as in a glass, the Bible, the Word of God, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We will never know God in eido. We will never be God, for Jesus only is God. But his is the kingdom, honor, glory, and power and dominion forever. He is the only Lord God. They're looking for the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. He knows the Father's eido because he is the Father that literally manifested himself in a body of flesh and blood. 1 Timothy 3:16, God was manifest in the flesh. Not the Son of God, God was manifest in the flesh. Now, for us, where I am, there you may be also. Now he has prepared a work for us. What is that work to usward? The glory to usward who believe. What he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Why? For we, the body of Christ, are made to sit together, S-I-T, down in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, where he's seated, S-I-T and S-E-T. That is a place of glory. S-I-T. Jesus did not sit, S-I-T, but he is S-E-T. The man is set down with the Father in his throne. That's settled. That's a state of glory. You'll see that in Revelation 3:21. Him that overcometh, that's us, the body of Christ. We shall sit down. I will grant to be set down with Jesus in his throne. That's an S-I-T. But Jesus did not S-I-T. He, even as I overcame, and him set, S-E-T, down with my Father in his throne. Why? Because Jesus is the Father of glory. There's a big difference in us seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, where we're set at the right hand of God, versus S-E-T, where Jesus is set, S-E-T, down with the Father in his throne. Why? Because he is the Father glorified back to his former glory. He became a man to work redemption, salvation, justification, sanctification, and ultimate glorification for his body. But after he finished the work, he went back to his former glory, take the glory back, sat down with the Father in his throne. Why? Because he is the Father. There, if you acknowledge that Jesus is the Christ, you have both the Father and the Son. Why? Because the Son has two components. He is the Spirit of God without measure, the Father of glory, in a body of flesh and blood. If you have just the Spirit without him coming in the days of his flesh, you only have the Spirit of God. But if you have the Father manifest in that body of flesh, you have the Son of God. Why? Because the Son is the Spirit of God. The of God is the flesh. The Son of God has two components, the Spirit without measure and a body of flesh and blood in the days of his flesh. So therefore, the Father in his humiliation as the Son of God was a man. In his glorification, the Father, and back in his glorification, is the Father of glory. Son of God, humiliation, a man, glorification, the Father. The Son of God in humiliation, a man, in his glorification, the Father. The Son of God in his humiliation, that is, the Son of God is the Father in his humiliation, revealed in a body of flesh and blood, a man, working as a man, praying to the Father. Working what? Because the veil is still there. Until that middle wall of partition and that ordinances of the law are fulfilled, Jesus, even though he's God, works salvation as a man. But when he finishes it and completes it and fulfills the law, then he literally breaks down this middle wall of partition, the veil of his flesh being ripped from top to bottom, the ordinances of the law that were contrary to us. That was a metal wall of partition between God and man. He broke down, nailing the ordinances of the law that were contrary to us, thereby the two making one new man, Christ in you, the hope of glory. That same Jesus was made a quickening spirit. Now he has a work for you to do in his stead. While God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, 2 Corinthians 5:17, now we pray you in Christ's stead, Paul said. We are ambassadors for Christ. We are in Christ's stead. Christ is in us now. And the work of the ministry is what he's preparing us all for. The work of the ministry, how do you get there and why and what is required of us? Well, we have to suffer with him. Oh, that is not a popular cross message today. We have a blessing gospel in America. That only if you give God $1, he'll give you back $10. If you give God $1,000, he'll give you back $2,000 and a glorified slot machine. That's not so. If those that are called in the Lord Jesus Christ, you're not only called to believe on Jesus, but also to suffer with him. You see, Paul said, we're troubled on every side, but not in distress, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed, always bearing about in our bodies the dying of the Lord Jesus. Why? That the life of the Lord Jesus may be manifest in our bodies. For we which live, all of us, which live are delivered unto death. Why? That the life of our Lord Jesus may be made manifest in our mortal bodies. Our light affliction, which is only but for a moment, what does it do for you? It worketh for you and me, all of us, an exceeding and greater weight of glory. For this light affliction, which is only but for a moment, worketh for us a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory for us to be revealed in Christ Jesus. Well, how are we going to be counted worthy for the kingdom of God? If you'll take a look at 2 Thessalonians 1, He said, your faith groweth exceedingly. What's growing? Your faith is. How do you grow in faith? You grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That is faith, is a substance of things hoped for. It's learning more of the eternal things that are not seen. The things which are seen are temporal, the things which are not seen. The eternal truths in Jesus, in the eternal world, he's revealing to his body. This is the faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. These things, Jesus said, I have many things to tell you, disciples. You're not able to bear it now, but when the comfort of the Holy Ghost has come, he'll speak of me, and what he hears, he'll declare unto you and show you things which will come. The revelation of Jesus Christ that God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. These things he's revealing right now in the last days as he's preparing us. Why? Because faith is a substance of things. And if we're earnestly contending for the faith that was once delivered to the saints, then we must suffer with him. As you see in 2 Thessalonians, the first chapter, that the faith groweth exceedingly. How does faith grow? We're growing up into him from glory to glory. In my distress, David said, I was enlarged. And not in your flesh, but enlarged in your spirit. And when the inner man is enlarged, it's filled again with the Holy Ghost. And every time you go through persecution and tribulation, the inner man, though the outward man perish, the inward man, Christ in you, that new creature is growing up into Jesus in all things. That's Christ in you, the hope of glory. The inward man that's growing up into the stature of Jesus Christ. How does it do it? By faith. How does faith grow? Seeing your faith groweth exceedingly, and every one of you, your charity aboundeth one toward another. We're bound to thank God for you, brethren, in all your tribulations and persecutions that you endure. Well, what would that have to do with it? All that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Somebody said, well, I'm not suffering any persecution. Then you're not preaching. You're not doing the work of the ministry, because all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Why? Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God. A manifest token? Yes. How do you know that you're in that kingdom? What's the token of it? If somebody said, I give you a car, what's the token of the car? Well, a keys to the car and a title. That's a token of that car. Here's the title, here's the keys. Well, what's a token of the kingdom of God? The tribulation and persecution that you endure, that you might be accounted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which we also suffer. Seeing is a righteous thing to render tribulation of them that have troubled you. In other words, it works the judgment of God. We, as a body of Christ, are going into birth pangs. There'll be tribulation and persecution, such as we've never known. Such as was a nation, neither shall ever be again. Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 10, Luke 21 tell us of these times. John 16, Jesus said, I have forewarned you that you should not be offended. The time will come when they deliver you up out of synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he did God a service. That's what's happening with Islam, Muslim right now. They kill you, they think they did Allah's service. Jesus said these days would come, John 16, 2. Look at John 16, 3. Why are they killing the Christian? Because these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. If you'd have known who Jesus is, you'd have known that he is the Father, because he is the Father of you. You know me, you know my Father. You've seen me, you've seen my Father. He is the Father manifest in a body of flesh and blood as the Son of God. For the Son of God is the Father revealed. The Father is the invisible spirit. The Son of God is the Father revealed in a body of flesh and blood. And that is in Christ, a great work that he's going to do, and we suffer with him that we might be accounted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which we also suffer. Now, we're in the dispensation of grace. But in this dispensation of grace, he said, during this time, you will preach this everlasting gospel to all the world, for a witness unto all nations, and then the end would come. Well, what glory will you preach it in? Will it be some denominational in this denomination and that denomination, and this one preaching some Jesus and that one? Or will we all be in the unity of faith until the knowledge of the Son of God? Not just the general knowledge of having the Holy Ghost, but the higher knowledge unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, unto a perfect man. And that's an epigenosko knowledge, a higher glory that we're all called for, which no man, no preacher, no apostle, no prophet, none of us have entered into yet, but is at the door as the Lord proceeds to glorify his body into his perfect image. You see, the bride will make herself ready, because Jesus is not coming back to a backbiting church, a church that has not made herself ready. He's coming back for a glorious church without spot, without blemish, that is not carnal, but perfect in all her ways. He will literally present to himself a perfect mirror image of himself to himself, a glorious church without spot or blemish. This is where we're headed. What kind of works does the Lord expect us to do? What kind of works will it be? If we're going to preach this everlasting gospel to the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come, will it be just a watered down gospel? Will it be just handing somebody a tract and say, "Know ye the Lord Jesus," while people are trying to kill the Christians, while they're overcoming by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives to the death? At the time that Christians are going through such a time of tribulation, that under that fifth seal in Revelation 6, I saw under the soul, under the altar in heaven, that's the altar of burnt offering, the altar in heaven, souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they said, "O Lord, holy and true, how long will it be before thou avenge our blood upon them that dwell upon the earth?" There's no soul sleep there, neighbor. 2 Corinthians 5, to be absent with the body is to be present with the Lord, and you know where you're at. 1 second after your Lord calls you home, "Oh, death, where's thy sting? Grave, where's thy victory?" You're going to know exactly where you're at. And he said, these ones there in Revelation 6, under the altar in heaven, under that altar, that's that brazen altar, the altar of burnt offering, they said, "Oh Lord, holy and true, how long will it be before you avenge our blood upon them that dwell on the earth?" The Lord gave them white robes of righteousness, which is, those white robes are the righteousness of the saints. And the Lord said unto those souls there, "Until your brethren and your fellow servants that will be killed as you were should be fulfilled." In other words, there's a lot more people that's going to seal their testimony with their own blood. There's a lot more the Church of the Living God that are going to be martyrs and witnesses for the Lord Jesus Christ, not only in Jerusalem, Judea, but unto the uttermost parts of the world. This is the everlasting gospel that right, "Blessed be he that dieth in the Lord, yea, saith the Spirit, that he may rest from his labors, and his works do follow him." What are we saying? Don't fear those that can kill the body, but fear him that's able to kill the body and destroy the soul in hell. That's who we fear. "So therefore in the last days, these things they will do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me." We're seeing outbreaks of terrorists and jihadist terrorism of Muslim and the Islamic faith, more so now as they are out to kill the infidels, the ones that do not confess Muhammad as their prophet and Allah their God. The law, they say, is the same as the only God. No, Jesus is our God, looking for the glory supreme of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, and him only will we serve. Well, they even unto death, whosoever will seek to save his life will lose it. But whosoever will lose his life for the gospel's sake, the same shall find it. So therefore, we will press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. We will not deny him, for if we deny him, he'll deny us. We will not deny our Lord Jesus Christ. Though we go into the fiery furnace, a time of tribulation, since there never was, since there was, neither shall there ever be again, since there was a nation. How much of the glory do you think we will have, the body of Christ, in preaching this everlasting gospel to the whole world? Somebody said, "I'm not a preacher." Oh yes, you are in the body of the Christ, you will be a preacher. Maybe you're not an apostle, maybe you're not a prophet, maybe you're not an evangelist, pastor, or teacher, but you will preach the everlasting gospel if you are in the body of Christ, because it will be a body ministry. And he will scatter the power of the holy people. And they will go forth for a time, times and a half, 3.5 years, 42 months, preaching this everlasting gospel to all the world. And then the end will come. In the book of Acts, in the 8th chapter, in the former reign, that is Pentecost, there abode only at Jerusalem the apostles only, for all the saints of God were scattered abroad. And they went everywhere, preaching and teaching the kingdom of God. And the book of Acts says, Luke, the beloved physician, writing, these that have turned the world upside down have come to our city also. That Pentecostal move turned the world upside down one time, overturned it one time. But in the last days, God said, I will overturn it. Why? Because this will be the last great reign of his strength. The former reign, this was that spoken by the prophet Joel in the day of Pentecost, and they had a great move of God. But what's going to come to pass in the last days, and the last great reign of his strength, will be far, far greater than what we've seen in the book of Acts. For the bride of Christ will grow up into him in all things. The Holy Ghost will lead and guide the body of Christ into all truth. And this is the work of God, created in his workmanship in Christ Jesus before the foundation of the world, unto good works, that they may see what? The body of Christ, good works, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Ye greater works than these shall you do. Jesus healed the sick, cleansed the leper, raised the dead, cast out devils, and opened blind eyes, and loosed the dumb tongue. And blessed was he who was ever not offended in Jesus. But Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do, because I go to my Father. I came from him, I go back to him. You're looking at him. Now, they're going to deliver you up to kings and magistrates. Take you no thought what you shall say or speak, for I will give you a mouth that they cannot gainsay nor resist. For it's not you that speaketh, but the Spirit of your Father that is in you, the Spirit of the Son. The Spirit of the Father, the Spirit of the Son is one and the self-same Spirit. Galatians 4:6 said, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son, which is his Spirit, the promise of the Father, which Jesus says, saith he, you've heard of me. He has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Why? The Spirit of the Son is the Spirit of the Father. The Son is the Father. If the Son is the Spirit, the Father, the Son is one and the same. The only difference is the Father's invisible. The Son is the image of the invisible God. It's the manifest Father in a days of his flesh. Well, that's what we're going to do now. Now Jesus has gone to the Father. Now we're in Christ's stead, and he expects us to fulfill that divine call of God and the commission in carrying this gospel into all the world. Not a Trinity gospel, not a binitarian gospel or two-ness, not a oneness, a God-man, but God himself, the man Christ Jesus, who is God, literally will be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then will the end come. The Jesus-only doctrine. Why do we say Jesus-only instead of the God-man doctrine? Well, because the true Jesus, when they came up, Jesus in a mountain apart in Matthew 17, he takes with him Peter, James, and John, and he went into a mountain apart. And as he went up there, they saw there appeared unto them Moses, Elijah, and Jesus. Peter said, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Let us build three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Well, Jesus, Son of God, which is the Father manifest, there he is. He did redemption miracles. Jesus never killed anyone. He healed the sick, cleansed the leper, raised the dead, cast out devils. He opened blind eyes. He loosed the dumb tongue. The captive went free. He always showed he was the resurrection and the life, a God of the living. But Moses did judgment miracles upon Egypt and all of the 10 different gods that they had. God destroyed every one of them through the judgment miracles of Moses. Not the judgment that will be given to the saints of the Most High God, but miracles of judgment. There's a difference in judgment being given to the saints of the Most High God, and you've been given a rod of iron whereby you will rule the nations, and I will give them that overcome the morning star in Revelation 2. That's altogether different from the work of God in the last days and the judgment miracles of Moses. Two different things. Oh, yes. Because one is in the dispensation of grace, the other one is in the kingdom age. You see, whenever Moses did those judgment miracles upon Egypt, he destroyed each of their gods. And he was a representative of the law. For as long as Moses is read today, the veil is still there. But when that veil, when Moses turns to Jesus, the law turns to Jesus, the veil is taken away. We see plainly that the law was a schoolmaster in Christ. It was all Christ, written of Christ, in the volume of the book. From Genesis to Revelation, it's all Christ Jesus. Not another God, not God Jr., not a second person of the Godhead, but God Himself who wrought salvation in and of Himself alone. Moses, a type of the law, and then we have Elijah as a type of the prophets. There, Elijah did kingdom miracles, things that were contrary to nature, miracles that he did. It rained not in the days of his prophecy by the space of 42 months, 3.5 years, in the days of Elijah, except according to his word. This Elijah, Eliyah, Elohim is Jehovah. It is the Isaiah, the salvation of Yah. Elohim is Jehovah. It is a revelation of Jesus. And he said, just as Elijah foreran Jesus' first coming, in the spirit of John the Baptist, in the spirit of Elijah, Jesus said, Elijah truly must first come and restore all things. Matthew 17. And restoring the restoration of all things in the times of these restitution, the heavens must receive Jesus. Acts 3, 20 and 21. For the heavens must receive Jesus. Stay there until the times of the restitution or restoration of all things. Why? Because the Lord is going to use his body in the restitution. Then during the millennial will be a time of regeneration, in the times of regenerating the earth. Regeneration, all things back to its former state, and Jesus himself will build that temple. Hallelujah unto God. We are preparing now in this dispensation of grace before the coming of the Lord to stir ourselves up for the work of the ministry, that we might be accounted worthy of the kingdom of God as he works in and through the body of Christ for this 3.5 years, 42 months, times and a half. Many people say that there was only two men that's going to do that in Revelation 11. But the reed likened to a rod given unto me, unto John, saying, rise and measure the temple. The temple of God is a naos. It is the spiritual temple. You are the lively stones whereby is built up a spiritual house, a spiritual temple whereby we offer praises unto God. We are, what know you not, your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. The temple of God is the church of the living God. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And that measuring the temple of God and the altar and them that worship therein are the saints of the living God, the church of the living God, the believers in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Christians of that day, of this day. Well, what happens? They're measured. Why? Because God is perfecting us. A reed likened to a rod to measure the temple of God, perfecting the saints of the living God, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, unto a perfect man, that he will present to himself a glorious church, a perfect church, without spot or blemish, that's grown up into him in all things, that we might be presented blameless at the coming of the Lord, spirit, soul, and body. No spot or blemish in it, the bride making herself ready. But you'll see in that Revelation 11, who are these two witnesses? Well, everything's done is done in the mouth of two witnesses. And they proclaim the testimony of Jesus. That is the word of God. That is the work of God to the law. Where's the law? The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, till the law and to the testimony. Those are the ones that have the testimony of Jesus in the last days in Revelation 12. They're the ones that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus, which is the remnant of the church that have obeyed God in all things. And they keep the commandments of God because they love God, and they have the testimony of Jesus, Revelation 19:10. And which is the spirit of prophecy, knowing those things, what the things of faith. Earnestly contended for the faith, they have literally come into that faith, and the Lord has counted them worthy of that kingdom of God, for they have obeyed him in obedience. The kingdom of God, the Holy Ghost is given to them that obey him. And this is grace, growing up in grace, growing in grace. Why? Because the grace comes to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ. The grace that comes to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ, the more that's revealed in him, the more that we grow in grace. That's 1 Peter 1. If you see there that this man-child will go into the wilderness where she has a place prepared of God, where she brings forth a man-child nourished from the face of the serpent for a time, times and dividing of a time, 3.5 years, 42 months, time, times and a half. Why? Because that's a remnant of her seed. That's the church that goes on and from Pentecost into the truth of Jesus Christ. Not sitting back and serving God half-heartedly, but coming into the knowledge of the Son of God, a higher glory, epigenosko, higher glory. The Revelation 11, somebody said, well, I thought that was Moses and Elijah. Somebody said, well, I thought that was Moses and Enoch. No, it tells you who these are. I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, 42 months, time, times and a half, 3.5 years. Why are they prophesying? Because that is the work of the ministry. Are there just two of them? The Coptic version of the Bible or whatever in the original manuscript says, and their dead body. Not bodies, body. Why? Because these bodies make up but one temple, one body of Jesus Christ, and that is the church. It did not say they're Moses and Elijah. It did not say, the scripture did not say, they're Moses and Enoch. Somebody said, well, these two never died, and they must die. No, no, no. Because it said in Revelation 11, who are these? These are the two olive trees and the two golden candlesticks. The candlesticks, the golden candlesticks, are the churches. Why two golden candlesticks? The candlesticks are the churches, Revelation 1. But they're golden candlesticks. Gold is the glory of God. The candlestick is the church. Why two? Because it's the two witnesses, that everything be established in the mouth of two witnesses. What are they? They are the two cherubim of glory, the two olive trees. How do you know that they are the cherubim? 1 Kings 6, verse 23 says, and you shall make the cherubim of two olive trees, 10 cubits high, of the cherubim of glory. And the two olive trees will be overlaid with gold. You see, in the Holy of Holies, and that's what the work of God is in the last days, that you and I in the body of Christ are called for. Because in this Ark of the Covenant, there is the horns of the altar up here in this Ark of the Covenant called the Testimony, and there at 2.5 cubits high, and this in there will have, had in the original, had Aaron's rod that budded and brought forth almonds, and that almonds is called Luz, which was first called, Bethel was first called Luz. Luz in Hebrew is almond. It's the first tree that dies in winter, the first one that resurrects in the spring, the almond tree. It's Luz, that is Luz is almond in Hebrew. Beth-El was first called Luz. One, Aaron's rod it budded. Two, you have manna. What is it? Manna that fell from heaven. This is the living bread that fell from heaven, which is Jesus said is my body that I give for you. I am that living bread. He is that manna. Well, and three, there was the tables of stone. In the Revelation, the second chapter, he said, I will give you to eat of the hidden manna. Why? It's not in that Ark of the Covenant anymore, because you've eaten it. What? That's the word of God. You've eaten Jesus' flesh and drank his blood. Then there's a reed likened to a rod. What's that? That's Aaron's rod that budded. Revelation 11:1, there's a reed likened to a rod given unto me, saying, rise and measure the temple of God. What's that rod? It's that rod that Jeremiah saw in Jeremiah 1. What do you see, Jeremiah? First vision he saw to the nations. I see a rod of an almond tree. That's a rod of Luz. That's a rod of Bethel. That's a rod of the church. Not the rod of Moses. It's a rod of the church in the last days. And I will give you a rod to rule the nations. That is the beginning of that Jesus ministry in that epigenosko, the knowledge of the Son of God, that you will preach this everlasting gospel to all the world for a witness in all nations, and then the end will come. Don't let anybody tell you all you're going to do is sit on a pew and it ain't ever going to happen. We've got right now tribulation and persecution breaking out in America on this soil, and it's going to get greater and greater, just as the Word of God has said, that evil men and seducers waxing worse and worse, delivering you up to synagogues, killing you, thinking they did God a service. These things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. They don't know the Christian faith. They do not know Christ, that he is the only Lord God. He is the Father who is the Son manifest. The Son is the manifested Father. It's only one God, not three, not two, not oneness, but one God, Jesus only. Well, that's the reason when Jesus came down off that mount, and that mount that was set apart, and they saw Moses, Jesus, and Elijah. Whenever Peter said, Lord, it's good for here, let us build three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. But he wist not what he said. He didn't know why he said it. Why did he say it? Everything in the Word of God has a revelation with it, a purpose, every jot and every tittle. Well, why? Well, simply because when they looked up after the dust settled, and they looked up, they didn't see Moses, they didn't see Elijah, they saw Jesus only. That's why at this church we are Jesus only in doctrine. Christ only, the only Lord God, the doctrine of Christ. So you see, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not the Father nor the Son. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. That's an antichrist in the last days. We think we're serving Jesus, but it's a false Jesus. Somebody said there's a false Jesus. Jesus said, many will come in my name saying I'm Christ, shall deceive many in my name. We have to know the work of God, not only his person, but the work as well. That's the reason why he said in that testimony, they call the Ark of the Covenant the testimony. Why? He said, now I've given you the eat of the hidden manna. I've given you a white stone that only he knows that receives it. A new name written. Not another name other than Jesus, but the new name is a new thing that God is doing. The new name is Jesus in a higher glory. Not gnosko in a knowledge of God, just knowing him after the Spirit, but an epigenosko, knowing him and hitting the mark. We've gone through the A through the Z. The Z is the mark. It's the Aleph Tav. It's the last letter of the Hebrew abecedary, because you've gone through all and you've now been led and guided into all truth. And that rod, well, the rod's not in there. Why? Because Aaron's rod that budded, he gave us a reed like unto a rod given unto me, John said, rise, measure the temple, the altar, and them that worship therein. There is Aaron's rod. It's right there in Revelation 11. What did Jeremiah see? I see the rod of an almond tree. Thou hast well seen. God said, I will hasten my word to perform it. In other words, the word being preached into all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end coming. That is exactly what God is preparing his bride for now. It is upon us, and whosoever does not stir himself up and suffers and in tribulation and persecution will not be worthy of this kingdom of God, for which we also suffer. So neighbor, if you're going through things, it's God. Thank God for it. Think it not strange the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice, inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, and the glory of God resteth upon you. You see in Revelation 11, that's a reed likened to a rod given unto you, the church of the living God, saying, rise, measure the temple of God, the altar, and them that worship therein. That was given to John. And he said, who are these? The tables of stone are still in there. Why? Because those tables are stone. There is a fulfillment of the law, not to do away with the law, but to fulfill that law, bring it to the higher glory. the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. He never did away with the law. He fulfilled the law. What do we have here? We have the true Jesus, which these will proclaim that true Jesus, the two olive trees. I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy for 1,260 days. Why? Because Jesus was cut off in the midst of the week, 3.5 years, but not for himself. And the bride of Christ will literally fulfill the week of Jesus in another 3.5 year work of the ministry, fulfilling Ephesians 4:11 according to his word. Every jot and every tittle will not fail until all will be manifest and revealed in the earth. These are the two olive trees. What are the two olive trees? In this ark, here you had here a cherubim and here a cherubim in the mercy seat, looking toward each other, in and of the mercy seat, looking toward each other, looking toward the blood of Jesus applied there upon the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. That blood made it a mercy seat. But these are not those cherubim. There are two cherubim, one here and one on the other side, that are 10 cubits high and have a wingspan of 5 cubits and literally touch the little walls of the Holy of Holies. That is a cedar work. The floor of Solomon's temple is fir, but the cedar work, cedar is the walls of salvation within the veil, and have cherubim of glory literally engraved upon the walls. This is two cherubim, or the golden ones inside of the mercy seat, which are the beaten work. Then we have the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat, which we cannot now speak particularly, Hebrews 9:5. What is the work of God? You are these two olive trees, not these two, the two golden ones in the mercy seat and the ark, but you are the two cherubim of glory, the two golden candlesticks, which is the churches on either side of the testimony. And these stand before the Lord of all the earth, and they empty out of themselves the golden oil. Not just the almond oil, but the golden oil. Why? Because this is throne room revelation. These two are the two witnesses caught up to God and to his throne. This is the church of the living God, not Moses, not Elijah. This is the church of the living God, the two golden candlesticks, the two olive trees, which stand before the Lord of glory and empty out of themselves the golden oil, Zechariah 4 and Revelation 11. And these will go forth preaching the everlasting gospel to the whole world. What are they preaching? They're prophets. Well, why not apostles? Because he set first in the church apostles, secondarily prophets. Why does he say these two prophets? They will preach there, and they will be hated of all the nations. Just as Jesus said, you will be hated of all nations in Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21. And some of you, they'll be killed. Well, two witnesses over there, they prophesy until their ministry is fulfilled. Then the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit killeth them, and their dead bodies shall stay upon the street of the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, wherein our Lord was crucified. Well, our Lord wasn't crucified in Sodom and Gomorrah, but it's the spirit of Sodom and Gomorrah, the streets of Sodom and Gomorrah, wherein also our Lord was crucified. This is spiritual speaking. This is a perverse spirit. They have come against the testimony of the Lord that he has given, the testimony of Jesus to the church in witnesses of the two golden candlesticks, the two olive trees. These are the two olive trees that he has set on either side of the testimony, because they have the testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy. Why do they have the spirit of prophecy? Because they are prophesying out of the book of this prophecy. That's the reason he doesn't call them apostles. He calls them prophets. What am I saying, neighbor? Prepare yourself for the greatest work that God will ever show upon the face of this earth. The greatest move of God and the greatest glory is about to be revealed. Well, this is Brother Dennis Beard. I see our time's gone. It's been a blessing in sharing this time with you. Take advantage of the gift. I know it'll be great for you. And until the next time, this is Brother Dennis Beard saying, behold the real Jesus.
Praise God. We count it an honor and a privilege to come into your homes and businesses. It's not counted a little thing with us. We appreciate the time that you give to us in this gospel of Jesus Christ. We're committed to the true gospel and the real Jesus. Because of that, we want to make an offer to you this month on a book that I wrote many years ago called The Eras of the Trinity. That's right. You heard it right. The Eras of the Trinity, which no apostle, even the epistles, even remotely, said anything of a three-person Godhead. But where did it come from? Where was the origin? How did it come into being in mainline Christianity? We're going to go into the Council of Nicaea, 325 A.D., the Chalcedonian definition of 451. All in this book, it'll give the details and the eras literally spelled out in the Word of God. I know it'll be a blessing to you. Along with that, we're going to make the DVD available, The Eras of the Trinity, the same, on a DVD format, going into the same material and how Jesus is only one, and the eras of the Trinity spelled out in the Nicene Creed and the Chalcedonian definition. For a gift of $20 or more, we want to make both the book, The Eras of the Trinity, and the Eras of the Trinity DVD available to you. If you will write, just mention offer JCIC, offer number 50. That's right, JCIC, offer number 50. Post Office Box 2906, Longview, Texas, zip code 75606. Again, that's the Heirs of the Trinity, offer number JCIC, number 50. You'll receive the book and the DVD for a gift of $20 or more. Write to us. We would love to hear from you. And there, mention the gift. It will keep the air broadcast on the air by your gifts and your offerings. We are so thankful for that. We're grateful to you. And until the next time, this is Brother Dennis Beard saying, behold the real Jesus.